Miles is going to be giving our 2011 Coase Lecture. This lecture, as many of you know, is normally given by a relatively younger member of the faculty and frequently about some element of law and economics. And the lecture series was created in 1992 in honor of Nobel laureate and Clifton R. Musser Professor Emeritus of Law, Ronald Coase, and is also supported by a grant from the John Olin Foundation to the Law and Economics Program. And you know, many of you who are taking property or perhaps contracts or torts, I've no doubt read about Professor Coase, and he is an amazing figure in the law. In fact, we just, a number of us went up and celebrated his 100th anniversary. He is still alive and kicking and writing, and we went up and celebrated his 100th birthday with him about 2 weeks ago. And we hope we'll be back at the law school soon. And when he comes, he will be proud that Tom Miles is someone who is bearing his name today. Tom is and I'm sure he's met Tom and talked to Tom on a number of occasions. The subject of discussion that Professor Miles is going to discuss is statistical studies of judicial behavior as well as theoretical work. On first impression, it might seem odd that economists, rather than political scientists, such as psychologists or lawyers, are studying the world of behavior of judges. But Professor Miles will explore with you why the economic approach to human behavior, as well as the tools of econometrics, have been especially fruitful in understanding how judges behave. And afterwards, I would just like to say, invite you all, there will be a reception following the lecture. First, let me just very briefly, a lot of you know Professor Miles, let me introduce him to you. Tom Miles received his BA degree in political science and economics, summa cum laude, from Tufts University. After college, he spent a year at the Boston Fed, or maybe more than a year. How many years did you spend? Two, three, whatever. So he's not as young. He's not that, except the younger faculty, not so. He's a research assistant at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, where he received the Bank President's Award for Outstanding Achievement. He then was a doctoral fellow at the American Bar Foundation and received his PhD in economics from the University of Chicago. He also received his JD degree from Harvard Law School. He was a clerk to the Honorable J.S. Bybee of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit. And before joining the law school, he was an Olin Fellow here in law and economics. Tom teaches courses in federal criminal law, regulation of securities, torts, economic analysis of law, seminar and empirical, law and economics. He writes in areas including criminal law as well as judicial behavior. And Tom was one of the first faculty members I got to know when I became dean of the law school. At that time, he was visiting, I was just named dean, hadn't even begun, and I knew that we had this really, really brilliant law professor who was visiting at Columbia. And I got all scared that we had a professor visiting at Columbia, so I went to New York, and Tom and I talked, and I'm very happy that Tom is here today and delivering the Coase Lecture. So I will not say this is your reward, this could be your punishment, but in any event, Tom, it's really my pleasure to introduce you to everybody.
Thanks very much, Dean Schill, for your introduction, which in some ways was a little too generous and a little too accurate. So it's a great pleasure to be giving this lecture today. As the dean said, my topic is economics of judicial behavior. And as the dean framed it, it's kind of an odd topic for a law and economics lecture. The behavior of judges, on first impression, doesn't really seem to be well suited to economic analysis. The terms of judicial employment insulate judges from the standard economic motivations. Judges have fixed salaries. They have a fixed set of inputs to help them in their work, fixed number of clerks, one secretary usually. They've got effective life tenure, which denies them any motivation from the chance of discharge, but also effectively denies them any motivation for the chance of promotion. The work that judges do typically seems unrelated to economics. Cases involving economic activities such as corporate law, antitrust law, are a very, very small part of a typical judge's docket. Making economics even seem to be a harder fit to understand what it is that judges do is that the outputs that judges produce are very difficult to quantify. Some people have tried to measure judges' output in terms of the number of opinions that they write, the number of cases they decide, the length of the opinions they write. But these sort of dimensions of a judge's decision and output really aren't the most relevant ones. The quality of the decision is what's most important. And so our students spend 3 years effectively trying to learn how to assess and how to themselves judge the quality of an opinion. And that makes it very hard for an economist, and particularly an empirical economist, to take those case decisions and turn them into something that could be measured and quantified. So as you already know, I hope you already know, the University of Chicago, its notion in its conception of economics is not limited to traditional topics of economics like inflation or unemployment. Under the influence of Professor Gary Becker, a Nobel laureate in the economics department, economics is no longer defined by a set of topics. Rather, it's a way of thinking about human behavior. And it's been fruitfully applied to areas such as discrimination, crime, family relationships, religion, a whole host of topics that we don't think normally as being having to do with economics. And the component of the economic way of thinking about human behavior that I want to seize upon today and try to apply or convince you has been fruitfully applied to judicial decision making is the idea that judges are rational actors who maximize a set of relatively static preferences subject to constraints. And the question that I want to ask today is whether or not this is a fruitful approach. So maybe it's best to start with a story. I'll tell you a story about me. As the dean mentioned, I've done some recent research on empirical studies of judicial behavior. And a persistent finding in these studies is that measures of a judge's political attitudes or political affiliations on average influence or seem to influence the way in which they decide cases. So a typical finding is that a judge who's thought to be politically conservative decides cases on average in a way that's more politically conservative than a judge who is measured to be a political liberal judge. And in my research, I found results similar to this. And so I was invited to present some of this research to a group of practicing lawyers. So I went and I presented this research. Then the floor was open to Q&A, and there was one lawyer who had been kind of surreptitiously checking his BlackBerry throughout most of the presentation. And he quickly raised his hand and said, "Don't we already know this? Aren't there 100 other studies that, maybe even 1,000 other studies that show these patterns? Why do we need another study like this?" So then I moved on to the second question. And the second question, the person raised their hand and said, "Every judge I know, including my spouse, who is a judge, decides cases according to the law." So I think your analysis must be deeply flawed if what you're showing is that judges decide their cases according to their ideological preferences. And I think in presenting results in a public forum like this, you are insulting the integrity of the judiciary. So there's this kind of old and maybe cynical joke that circulates among economists about the challenge or maybe futility of presenting empirical analysis to lawyers. And the joke goes like this. Lawyers have only two reactions to statistical analysis. It's obvious or it's wrong. And so you can imagine my delight when in a single presentation I had achieved both obviousness and wrong. So my argument today is that effectively both of these reactions are incorrect or inappropriate. That recent studies of judicial behavior have a lot to say about judicial decision making, and this evidence is not wrong and it's not an insult to the judiciary. And a lot of this work is being done by economists or what I'll call law and economists, legal academics who take an economic viewpoint. And moreover, I'll be even more precise, at the risk of self-congratulation, a lot of this work has been done by folks in academics, economists, who are either at or affiliated with the University of Chicago. The bulk of the advances, I think, have been empirical in nature, but there's also important theoretical work being done. And I think as one looks across the entire literature that is emerging, what one sees is a conception or a model of judicial behavior that's inherently economic, that's more complex and more nuanced than either of the standard reactions to this kind of literature appreciate. So my remarks then focus on economists, and not to say that there isn't important work, both in the past and currently, being done on judicial behavior by political scientists and by psychologists. In fact, I think the work that economists do builds upon the work of political scientists in particular. But as this is the Coase Lecture, I want to focus on the work and contributions of economists and law and economics. So perhaps it's best to start with those two reactions to my presentation. And to ask, say, what is it about the empirical literature on judicial decision making that elicits these sorts of reactions? And so let me begin quite consciously with what is a cartoon version or caricature of the literature and how someone who is critical of the literature might see it. And so it might go like this. The standard approach in one of these studies is to examine how the characteristics of justices or judges relate to how cases are decided. And the researcher then would go and gather a set of cases or decisions, typically from the Supreme Court, and then also develop measures of a justice's political ideology. Maybe a column that's commonly used is party appointing president, but there are a variety of other more complex measures that are used. And the idea then is to see how these characteristics affect the judge's propensity to vote in a certain way. And it might be voting in a way such as, like, you know, the outcome will be, does the appellate prevail? And these studies were typically framed as a test of two competing hypotheses. So one hypothesis was that if the judge followed the law, the justice's characteristics shouldn't matter to whether or not the appellant prevailed. That is a finding that the judge's characteristics, and in particular the measures of the judge's political ideology, correlated with the likelihood that the appellant prevailed. The judge must not have followed, I'm sorry, the A finding that the justice's ideological preferences or measures of those preferences did not correlate with the appellant's likelihood of victory, the judge must have followed the law. The law must have determined the outcome of the cases, not the judge's personal views. The competing hypothesis was that if a judge's characteristics, especially these proxies for ideology, correlated with the likelihood of the appellant's victory, then the judge's own views must have overcome or overborne the law, and judicial attitudes rather than law determined case outcomes. This was kind of framed as a test of the legal way of doing things, the legal model versus the attitudinal model. And the way a typical finding would be expressed would be to say a change in X units of the measure of ideology would lead to a change of Y units in the probability of voting for the appellant. And when this estimate was statistically significant, we would draw the conclusion that the evidence indicated that a so-called extra legal factor, the political ideology of the judge, influenced the case outcomes. It was taken as a confirmation of the triumph of attitudes over law. Now, I think it's fair to say that this is how critics often perceive work in this area, and I think they labor under a misimpression. And the misimpression leads to a sort of set of implications. One implication is they read the literature as being a gotcha literature. Those judges, they say they're applying the law, but in fact, statistical analysis reveals that they're really imposing their own attitudes and preferences. And these studies would then be repeated across a whole area of different areas of law, constitutional law, criminal law, employment law, and each time the result would be gotcha. So authors of such studies then seemingly would be accusing judges of wrongdoing, and yet they would face this challenge of trying to reconcile their statistical findings with the insistence from sitting judges that what they do is, in fact, apply the law. So at the risk of antagonizing the audience, I think it's worth pointing out that at this point, this kind of reading of this literature, I think, feeds into a certain kind of cynicism about judges and about opinion writing that I think law students are particularly susceptible to, and particularly first-year law students are susceptible to. So often law students come to law school expecting to learn the law, capital T, capital L. That is, they expect to learn a set of rules or codes that are presumably long and complex. You know, long hours memorizing the contents of shelves of leather-bound volumes are thought to be the three-year task that awaits them. Now, at some point, maybe it's the first day, maybe it's sometime later, often it's during the first year, the student realizes that the law is less mechanistic than they expected. And this is sometimes a surprise and sometimes lead to frustration. And then the student has more kind of troubling encounters. Maybe it's an encounter with Mrs. Paul's graph and the dropped package. Maybe it's an encounter with a wild and noxious fox, an encounter with castaways who resort to cannibalism, or an encounter with nephew William's promise to refrain from tobacco, cards, billiards, and drinking. But it could be any number of encounters. At some point, these encounters cause the pendulum to swing in the other direction. And the law student feels tempted to conclude that judges enjoy free rein to do whatever they want. They can render decisions that are crassly political or weirdly idiosyncratic. And this is the point at which sort of classrooms rumble with embittered references to the judge's breakfast. The temptation is to believe that there's no law. Frustration has become despair, and despair, nihilism. So I think law students should resist this temptation. Law, true, is not as mechanical as perhaps we first imagined, but neither is it the caprice of those on the bench. And I think there are at least two good reasons for both scholars and students to avoid the kind of reading of the empirical evidence that I've described. And that is to say, the evidence is not a confirmation that judicial attitudes explain all and law nothing, nor is it an indictment that judges disregard law. To put the empirical study of judges into perspective, it's worth asking first, how big is the magnitude of the estimated effect of judicial attitudes? If a one-unit change in the measure of the judge's or justice's ideology leads to a y-unit change in the probability of a judge voting a certain way, is this big or is this small? So one way to think about this is to try to get a sense of how much of the variation in the likelihood of, say, the appellant prevailing is explained by the justice's attitudes or the measures of the justice's attitudes. Let's say the judge's attitudes explained 10% of the variation in the appellant prevailing. Now, from the perspective of social science, this would be an incredibly strong finding. But if it is 10%, then what accounts for the remaining 90%? Maybe there's some additional control variables in the analysis. Maybe that gets it down to 80% or 70%. But then what is the big unexplained residual? What's left? Now, in many of the early studies of judicial decision-making, there were no direct measures of law included. Does that mean that perhaps the unexplained portion was in fact law? In which case, if law explains 90% of the case outcomes, and I'm not saying that it did, but if it explained 90% of the case outcomes and judicial preferences 10%, suddenly gotcha doesn't seem to be the right reaction. So a second reason to interpret these estimates or these kind of results with some caution is the data sets on which these statistical analyses are conducted. So early research focused almost exclusively on the Supreme Court, and the cases reaching the court, of course, are not representative of the typical lawsuit. They're litigated from trial court all the way up to the appellate courts to the Supreme Court, and even upon reaching the Supreme Court, the cases that are actually heard are not typical of the cases that come to the court's doorstep. The court, in the exercise of its discretion, agrees to hear only an infinitesimally small fraction of the cases seeking to be heard. And this suggests that the cases examined in the empirical studies are quite simply not typical, and there's good reason to think they're the hard ones. So the idea that litigated cases aren't representative of all cases is a well-established idea in law and economics. In 1986, professors George Priest and Benjamin Klein hypothesized about when do trials occur. And in their theory, trials occur when both litigants are really optimistic about the chances of success at trial. If one party were optimistic and one pessimistic, then settlement would occur. Thus, those cases that proceed to trial, not only are both parties optimistic, but the cases that go to trial are a non-random or non-representative sample of all legal disputes. Priest and Klein further predicted, and controversially predicted, that under certain technical conditions, the rate at which plaintiffs would prevail at trial would approach 50%. In other words, among cases going to trial, the plaintiff would be as likely to win as to lose. Now, you can see a similar logic applies to appeals. Only optimistic litigants are going to shoulder the burden of seeking an appeal rather than settling. And thus, the cases reaching appellate court are likely to be those having strong legal arguments on both sides. Now, of course, the idea that cases reaching the appellate stage might have two equally plausible legal solutions is not a new idea. It's not unique to economics. The legal realists, all the way back in the 1930s, in reacting to formalism, emphasized the indeterminacy of law. That is, the set of available legal materials rarely supplied definitive answers to legal questions, at least in hard cases. And as our colleague Brian Leiter has pointed out in his work on the legal realists, the realists envisioned indeterminacy as most relevant to the appellate review stage, the domain of hard cases where one would expect a higher degree of uncertainty in law. So in view of all this, it seems entirely plausible that the set of appellate decisions, particularly Supreme Court decisions, are those in which the law is likely to be indeterminate, and into this indeterminacy steps the influence of individual judges. Now, none of this is inconsistent with the possibility that in a different set of cases, perhaps a large set of cases, law might be completely determinative and leave no room for the influence of judicial attitudes. So these two features of what we might think of as either the early literature on judicial decision making or this kind of cartoon version of how the literature is perceived limited kind of the explanatory power of the estimates and suggest that any claim about the primacy of attitudes over law is premature. Now, I don't wish to be too critical of the reactions that this literature often engenders. I think a lot of the work that's come recently is well aware of the criticisms that I've just articulated. There's nothing new in what I've said. In fact, I'm repeating the works of other, repeating the sort of perspectives of others. In fact, these are sort of stock criticisms. And this early work was important. These were the first studies that provided empirical, and by which I mean sort of a large N statistical confirmation, that judges weren't automatons. In instances of legal indeterminacy, the identity of a judge to whom discretion was granted mattered. That the characteristics of judges with particular, that the characteristics of judges correlated with particular outcomes suggested that judges differed systematically in how cases were resolved. That is, judges had preferences over individual outcomes. And so this is a first important step then that allows us to think about how to apply the economic model. We have an idea about what is it that judges have preferences over. So one is, in a very narrow and simplistic way, they have preferences over outcomes in individual cases. So now let me turn to sort of the contributions of economists, and particularly in the past 15 years, to the study of judicial behavior. And my claim, again, is that the economists have fleshed out a rational choice conception of judicial behavior. So let me begin, then, with thinking about both the preferences of judges, what it is that they're looking to maximize, and also the constraints that bind them. So let me think first about the constraints. And I'll put constraints into two categories: institutional structures and the law itself. So with regard to institutional structures, it's got to be pointed out that much of the recent work on judicial behavior has shifted attention away from the Supreme Court and toward the federal circuit courts. And this shift is partly made for practical reasons. The first generation of political scientists that examined the Supreme Court, they did a really good job in certain regards. They didn't leave kind of any stone unturned. And so it was very hard then to think of novel questions to ask about Supreme Court behavior. And naturally, people began to worry, think then about other courts. In addition, circuit courts handle a much larger number of cases. This both helps with statistical inference, but also, and more importantly, indicates that circuit courts are where the bulk of appellate decision-making occurs. So unlike the circuit courts, The circuit courts, unlike the Supreme Court, don't have a discretionary docket. They've got to take every case that comes to them. And this creates a problem about how to assign cases to judges. And the way the circuit courts have resolved this is to have a process that's said to be random assignment. And from the perspective of doing an empirical analysis, random assignment's terrific. It's important because it provides effectively what is an experimental condition. It permits the researcher to draw plausibly causal inferences about the impact of a judge's characteristics on the case outcomes. And given the desire to learn about how the judge influences the decisions, it's important also to look at judges who are bound by a higher court's precedence. And so it's important to look at circuit courts. So circuit courts, they hear cases in panels of three judges. And as a first institutional feature, it makes sense to look at, well, who are the other judges, who are the other judges on the panel? Who are they sitting with? And it's now a standard finding in the literature that a judge sitting on a panel with two judges who share that judge's political inclinations are more likely to vote in a predictably ideological way than when compared to when the judge sits with one judge who shares their ideological perspective and one who doesn't. Now, it's also a standard finding that when a judge sits with two judges who don't have the same political preferences or same ideological worldview, that judge is much less likely to vote in a predictably ideological way than when he or she sits with one similarly inclined judge and one oppositely inclined judge. So to try to make this concrete, consider a Republican appointee sitting with two other Republican appointees as compared to when that Republican appointee sits with one Republican appointee and one Democratic appointee. In that instance of sitting with two Republicans, that judge is much more likely to vote in a predictably ideological way, that is to vote in a conservative way. And then next, compare the situation when this Republican appointee sits with two Democratic appointees as compared to when that Republican appointee sits with one Democrat and one Republican appointee. In that instance of sitting with two Democratic appointees, the Republican appointee is much more likely to vote against type, much more likely to vote in the conventionally liberal way. Now, of course, one could reverse the party affiliations and come out with a completely symmetric claim. And these patterns acquired a name of panel effects. And our former colleague, Cass Sunstein, had names for the two versions of the panel effect. He called the first one ideological amplification. And the second one, when moving against type, when sitting with members of the judiciary who are of a different view, ideological dampening. Now, the idea of panel effects kind of burst into the consciousness of legal academics following, I think it's fair to say, the publication of Professor Richard Revez's 1997 study of environmental law decisions in the DC Circuit Court of Appeals. His study showed pronounced panel effects. And subsequent scholars have further investigated panel effects. Cass Sunstein in a series of articles and ultimately a book, which I hasten to add was co-authored with current Bigelow fellow Andres Zwicky, found that panel effects were pervasive in federal appellate decisions. They were present in virtually every area of law with a few exceptions. And the idea that panel effects has become so powerful that it's now standard in empirical studies to include them as controls, and if a researcher doesn't include them as controls, that's typically viewed with some suspicion. So while they're pervasive, the causes of them are not well understood. And the possible explanations for panel effects are many. There are psychological accounts. Individuals may be more likely to go to extremes when they're in groups with like-minded people. And they may be more likely to moderate their positions when they're surrounded by differing viewpoints. Other accounts are strategic. Judges might engage in the kind of log rolling typically associated with legislators. They may acquiesce to an undesired outcome in exchange for a colleague's reciprocity in another, or a judge may consent to a particular outcome in a case in exchange for changes in the majority's reasoning. In this way, judges may trade a specific outcome against the precedential value or content of an opinion. Now, which account is the correct explanation for panel effects remains unresolved. But I think here's one instance where law and economists are making important tests and important progress. And let me give you two examples. So one example is a recent paper by Professor Stephen Choi and Meetu Gulati, and Professor Gulati visited here last term. They found some evidence of moderation in partisan language and opinions from ideologically mixed panels in low salience cases. Got that? Let me say that again. What they found was evidence of moderation in what they termed partisan language. They looked at a set of opinions and then came up with a way to classify how partisan the language in that opinion was. And then they looked at politically mixed panels, panels where we think panel effects are going to be most easy to detect. And they said, do they see moderation when the panel is mixed in the sort of polarization or partisan language of the opinion? In other words, in mixed panels, do we see the content of the opinion or this proxy for the content of the opinion moderating? And what they found was some moderation in this set of cases which they determined to be low salience, a set of cases in which the issues involved are not particularly polarizing. And so this is consistent with this idea of strategic decisions, potential trades being made among judges. But importantly, the patterns they detected didn't prevail in the set of high salience cases. So a kind of mixed verdict from their evidence. So another important attempt to try to figure out what are the causes of panel effects is a recent article by Professors Lee Epstein and our own Professor William Landis and Judge Posner. And I should stop and point out here what a kind of remarkable collaboration this is. You get Landis and Posner, the two giants of law and economics, the kind of brand name of law and economics, co-authoring with Professor Lee Epstein, who's the leading political scientist of the Supreme Court. I think this collaboration itself shows kind of how far we've come in thinking about the role of economics to try to understand judicial behavior. And so I think their collaboration is a large one and has many components to it, but let me just focus on this one aspect, which is their attempt to explain panel effects with what they call dissent aversion. What do they mean by dissent aversion? Well, they theorize that dissenting is costly, and costly in two senses. One, there's an effort cost to actually sitting down and writing the dissent. There's also a cost, which is somewhat more ethereal, a cost to the judge's relationships with the judge's other colleagues on the bench. The dissent kind of frays collegiality. And thus, judges, although they want a particular outcome in a case, and when they realize they're not going to prevail, they want to dissent, they have to weigh the gains from that dissent against these costs. And so Professors Epstein, Landis, and Judge Posner predict that the effort cost of writing a dissent will be higher when the judge has a heavier caseload, and that the collegiality cost of dissent will be greater when the judge has a high future likelihood of interacting with their colleagues. And when will there be that high likelihood of future interactions? Well, when they sit in a circuit that's relatively small. If they sit in a very large circuit, well, there's a good chance they won't see their colleague again for several years. But in a small circuit, they're going to see them perhaps every day. So they test these predictions using 25 years of data from the circuit courts. And they find strong support for these economic predictions. They find that dissents are fewer in smaller circuits and in circuits with heavier caseloads. And I think what's especially convincing about their evidence is that they look at the split of the Fifth Circuit in 1981. The Fifth Circuit was split because it was had a heavy caseload into the Fifth and into the 11th Circuit. And this split was like a random shock to the size of the court, dramatically reducing the number of judges. And the dissent rate fell immediately in response to the split. So these two sets of studies, one trying to look at and trying to code and classify the actual content of decisions, and the other one looking at the rate of dissent and its relationships to institutional characteristics in the court, provides some evidence, right, that institutional features of the court matter. So, of course, there's another institutional feature that influences or constrains a judge's review by higher courts. Appellate decisions, of course, are subject to review en banc or by the Supreme Court, but relative to the whole volume of decisions, that's quite rare. Instead, review by a higher court is most relevant for district courts. And a number of scholars study the behavior of district court judges, and I want to highlight just one example or one strand of that work. So Professors Max Schanzenbeck and Emerson Tiller at Northwestern have produced a series of papers, one of which was published in Chicago's Law Review, that examines how federal judges assign sentences to criminal defendants. And they give particular relationship between the sentencing judge's ideological identity or preference and the ideological preferences or identity of the appellate court above the sentencing judge. And their prediction is that when the court and the sentencing judge share the same ideological preferences, that is to say, when their preferences are aligned, the sentencing judge is more likely to sentence in a predictably ideological way. And they test this prediction against a large set of federal sentences. And they found that on average, the prison term assigned by a Democratic appointee relative to the prison term assigned by a Republican appointee falls as the proportion of Democratic appointees on the appellate court above increases. In other words, sentencing judges appear responsive to the preferences of the judges who will review their decisions. The threat, or at least the possibility, of appellate review appears to constrain the decisions of district court judges. So now we have two possible ways in which the institutions constrain judges, both the panels in which they sit and the prevailing court above. Other constraints? Well, kind of oddly, we haven't talked about law yet. There are several pieces of scholarship that have emerged that try to look at how judicial ideology interacts with legal doctrine. And so here, I'll be self-serving and focus on one illustration from my own research. And the example is from a collaboration that Professor Adam Cox and I undertook a few years ago. We examined how federal judges decided cases arising under Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act. Now, Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act creates a private right of action authorizing minority voters to sue in federal court to secure their voting rights. Often, their suits advance claims of vote dilution, that particular electoral rules or practices unlawfully dilute the votes of minority voters. And in 1982, Section 2 was amended to make clear that the plaintiff did not have to prove that a voting rule or voting practice was maintained for invidious purpose. In other words, the plaintiff did not have to prove that the voting rule or voting practice was the result of discriminatory intent in order to make out their claim of vote dilution. Subsequent to this amendment, the Supreme Court interpreted that provision in a case called Thornburg against Jingles. Now, in Jingles and subsequent decisions, the court fashioned a new doctrinal framework for analyzing these Section 2 claims. And the doctrinal framework consisted of two parts. One part was the first step, which was a rigid kind of rule-like inquiry into three preconditions of liability. If these three conditions were met, the case could go forward. And then the second stage was to look at the totality of the circumstance. So it was kind of a softer, standard-like test. And in effect, what this doctrinal framework does is it requires the reviewing court to apply a rule and then apply a standard. So now, one of the central controversies of law, perhaps the central controversy of law, is the debate over rules versus standards. And yet, empirical evidence on it is startlingly scarce. The doctrinal framework of Jingles, then, was exciting because it provided an opportunity to test whether there was any difference in how judges analyzed rules versus how they analyzed standards. And our prediction was that the greater indeterminacy and the greater flexibility of standards should imply that ideological differences between judges should be greater in the application of the standard than in the application of the rule. So we examined the set of Section 2 cases in circuit courts since Jingles, and we found several interesting patterns. So one was that judges actually applied the Jingles framework. Lower courts followed the precedent the Supreme Court had articulated, itself a confirmation that law matters. Second, with respect to case outcomes, the ultimate outcome, whether or not there would be liability under Section 2, we found the patterns familiar from other types of studies. That is, a judge's political ideology seemed to be correlated with the plaintiff's success. And there were strong panel effects with regard to the outcome of whether or not the plaintiff would prevail. But when we looked beyond just simply who wins and who loses, and we looked at the doctrinal steps, a very different pattern emerged. we found that ideological divisions in voting patterns were much more pronounced in the standard-like step than in the rule-like step. And moreover, under the rule-like step, judges voted less often in a predictably ideological way, so much less often that we couldn't distinguish who were the Democrats and who were the Republican appointees. Which is to say that a judge's political preferences didn't correlate with the likelihood of the resolution of the rule-like inquiry. And we think these results provide an important support for the idea that rules, to a greater extent than standards, limit judicial discretion and potentially suppress ideological disagreements among judges. Okay, so now I've talked about constraints on judges, institutional, and the law itself. Let me turn in for a few minutes to talk about judicial preferences. And so we've been talking about judicial preferences as being about the specific case in front of them. Now, maybe that's too obvious to point out, but do judges care about things other than what's the outcome of the immediate case before them? Well, of course. We think one of the most important pieces of their output is the content of the law they produce. And so law and economists have begun to look at that too. And as I said at the outset, that's one of the hardest things to try to quantify. And so economists and law and economists have been very creative, I think, in recent years in an effort to try to get a handle on ways to test this. So an example is, remember the study I mentioned a few moments ago by Professors Schonzenbach and Tiller. They found that sentencing judges were responsive to the possibility of appellate review. Their findings are, in fact, more precise than I first described, and let me now be more precise about what their findings were. During the period of their study, sentencing in federal courts was governed by a set of mandatory guidelines. A judge wishing to deviate from the sentence determined by the guidelines had two choices. She could make an adjustment to the offense level. That was mostly a fact-based determination. Or she could make a departure. And the departure was more a law-based conclusion. Since appellate courts decide questions of law, departures, rather than adjustments, face stricter review in the appeals court. Now, what the professors predicted, and what in fact they found evidence of, was that the sentencing judge in the appeals court, was that when the sentencing judge in the appeals court that was going to review the sentencing decision shared the same ideological attitude or perspective, the judge was more likely to alter the sentence under the departure, the law-based criteria, rather than an adjustment, the fact-based criteria. And it went the opposite way when the judge and the reviewing court were not aligned. The judge was more likely to pursue the fact-based manner of altering the sentence. And I think these results suggest several things. One of the implications is that judges have preferences over not just the outcomes in specific cases, but also over the content of legal precedents that their decisions might establish. The evidence suggests that judges take the opportunity to base their decisions on law rather than fact when there's a good chance that the decision will be affirmed by the appellate court and become precedent. Now, the empirical evidence raises interesting questions itself about precedents. If in instances where judges do possess discretion, can they embed their preferences in precedent? And then what are the implications for the content of law? So some years ago, Judge Posner advanced the hypothesis that the common law would evolve to efficiency. The reason for this was that even if judges didn't normatively favor efficiency, inefficient decisions were more likely to be relitigated and thus more likely to be subject to opportunities for change. Now, this was a controversial and much contested claim. But recently, several economists, most prominently Andre Schleifer and Nicola Jenny Iola, have revisited the question with the tools of sophisticated modeling. In one paper, they developed a model in which judges could either adhere to precedent or distinguish it. And that choice would be influenced in part by the judge's policy preferences. And in their model, they derive conditions under which the common law will evolve toward efficiency or not. Their conclusion was that when judges are motivated by their personal agendas, legal evolution tends to be beneficial, in part because personal biases of the judges wash out, but also because law becomes more precise as more distinctions are made. and a more precise law is more beneficial. Now, they call this result, in a tip of their hat to the Coase theorem, the Cardozo theorem. Now, Professor Schleifer and Judge Posner and our Bigelow fellow Anthony Niblett have recently conducted the first set of empirical tests of whether or not the common law evolves towards efficiency. It's surprising that it's taken this long for there to be an empirical test. And what their test does is it looks at the legal content of economic loss rule decisions. And they examine the state laws, the state court's adherence to this rule in a large sample of construction disputes. And quite simply, their evidence did not support the efficient evolution hypothesis. I mean, never let it be said that economists' predictions are always confirmed. The law did not converge to any stable resting point, and there were significant differences across states. Now, I suspect that this is a first test of a longstanding and controversial claim. And I think it's going to inspire more work on the subject, but it shows the ways in which economists are taking seriously how can they go about linking their empirical measures to, how can they develop empirical measures of legal content, and then how can they test that against predictions of economic behavior. So a final outcome or output that judges may have preferences over is, of course, their reputation. And I think it was Professor Landis who was the first to develop a metric of judicial reputation by studying the number of citations opinions authored by each judge received. And this work has inspired others, most notably Professors Choi and Gulati, who combined citation measures with other metrics of a judge's productivity and other measures of a judge's independence. And they try to create metrics or scores that allow them to rank the performance of judges. And recently, Professor Choi and Gulati have teamed with Professor Eric Posner and produced a series of papers that, in effect, conduct these style of performance evaluations of state court judges. And they've asked which state courts are best, whether state court judges are overpaid. And I think this work is important for several reasons. One, it sheds much needed light on state courts, which until now have rarely received empirical attention. And that's odd because state courts are far more likely than federal courts are far larger in terms of the number of judges and in terms of the number of cases handled. And I think the professor's efforts to develop specific measures of judicial performance could perhaps have far-reaching and wide application. So there's much more that could be said about the contribution of economics to the understanding of judicial behavior, and I've been in many ways unfair to many writers in the field because I've not mentioned their work, but I hope that what I've said so far convinces you that economics and law and economics are being fruitfully applied to economic thinking, being fruitfully applied to judicial behavior by specifying judges' preferences more fully and by articulating more precisely the constraints under which judges operate, and empirical evidence testing these predictions is being brought to bear in a careful and thoughtful way. Far be it from me to say whether this kind of emerging body of work from so many scholars, many of them connected in various ways with Chicago, represents a new Chicago school of judicial behavior. But I think it's safe to say that law and economics has a lot to teach us about the behavior of judges, a lot to teach us that's neither wrong nor obvious.
And second, do you really believe that law and policy or law and politics are different? If you look at most decisions that are studied in law school, most influential decisions, they're not generated by deduction from orthodox legal materials, right? They're creative, they're legislative in character. They're still law, aren't they?
Great. I thought I'd faced hostile audiences before. What did I learn from my clerkship about judicial behavior? I guess, narrowly speaking, what I learned is, wow, the Ninth Circuit's a really unique place, and a very interesting place. And I think what I learned about it was that judges really care about the content of their decisions. Sure, there were some judges that I observed that maybe weren't as engaged as one hopes they would be, but by and large, most of them really were engaged. And cared very deeply about the content of the decisions they made, even when the content of it seemed kind of obscure, and that it was something about sort of finer points of law. So that very much impressed me. Now, the distinction between law and policy is, of course, you know, a difficult one, and it's hard to think about what are the, I mean, you present the hardest case by saying, look at the cases that we teach in casebooks. Because, of course, the ones that we teach in casebooks, you know, are, by their very nature, they're not meant to be the typical case. They're meant to be the very, very hard case. And why are they hard? Well, they're hard because the legal materials are indeterminate, and it's into that space that judicial preferences or policy moves. So I think that just because there are instances where these precedents, and some of them are quite important, but some of them are in casebooks because they're atypical, it also means that beyond these hard cases, there's a set of cases that are clearly governed by law, right? And I think that there can be a distinction, but as we move to the sort of the hardest cases, it does become blurred. I agree.
Let me preface this by saying that 40 years before you, I clerked in the Ninth, and I learned those things. And it's a wonderful experience which people ought to do if they can. Yesterday, the Illinois Appellate Court threw Rahm Emanuel off the ballot, 2-1. Supreme Court of Illinois has taken the case. Morning paper reports that the two judges who threw him off are former employees of Alderman Edward Burke, who supports a different candidate. The paper also reports the Illinois Supreme Court has 3 Democrats, 3 Republicans. The Republicans will vote to keep him off the ballot. The Democrats will vote for him. That would be an affirmance. There's a 7th member. Her name is Ann Burke. She's married to the alderman. So the crucial question in the Illinois Supreme Court is she indebted to her husband for her job? Or is she an independent woman who will vote whatever the law requires? Can you subsume those facts in your matrix?
Now, typically we don't have those kinds of facts in our matrix, right? I mean, most of the literature that I've spoken about are instances of federal appointee. We look at federal courts typically, and typically the measure of what is a judge's political preference is a very crude one, right? The typical one that's used is just what is the political party of the president who appointed this judge? Now, some will try to use a more refined measure, such as, you know, what was the composition of the Senate that confirmed the judge? What were the, if we believe that there's senatorial courtesy, what were the characteristics of the senators from the home state that controlled this seat? But those are all, you know, still at a much, much higher level of abstraction than the nuanced detail that you describe. And so can, you know, the matrices of the statistical analysis capture that? No, quite frankly.
Problem that any abstract analysis will always be less useful than actually knowing the facts on the ground.
Now, I agree. I mean, I don't think that we need to, like, we shouldn't replace, you know, this is not an argument to say that we should replace judicial decision making with a set of, you know, computer models. It's true, though, that oftentimes what we can learn from a sort of large end study is that we can, you know, they're useful because what they can do is they can test hypotheses about behavior that isn't possible when we just read individual cases one by one. And so this provides, and I don't view this sort of evidence as being in competition with actual reading of cases. Of course, that's important. That's what we're training students to do. But I view this evidence as being a set of evidence that also provides a different set of insights, even if it does not provide specific resolutions of specific instances.
So I have two questions. One just follows up on that question. Can you look at the data that are typically used in your studies and the other ones that you cite and try to figure out if the problem is there are some judges that are very political and other judges that are not very political? Is the problem that there are some cases that are very political and other cases are not? Or is it that in every case, there's some amount of preference inserted into the decision making? Because those lead to different normative conclusions about what we should do about it. The second question is, I want to get back to that 90-10 number. You were tossing it out as a hypothetical about what fraction of cases on average or decision making on average is influenced by preferences versus law. Looking at the data, for example, that you've analyzed, can you tell us what percentage of the variance in outcomes are explained by some proxy for preference, assuming that the rest is, you know, law?
Sure. I proposed my hypothetical of 10% as being one where, wow, that would be a very, very strong finding. I think a more typical and typical of the findings that I've had, it's been about 4%, right? So it's a really small portion of the variation. But what that means is that even if one puts in all the other control variables one has, one's explaining a relatively small portion of the variation. I mean, as you know, in a typical cross-section, like in a labor economic study, say, if one can explain a third of the variation in the outcome, that's considered a pretty good result. And in the area of judicial decision-making, the results just simply aren't that strong. They're typically explaining something like half that, right? So then I think it is a very hard question to ask, well, what is the residual? What is the rest? Is it law? Or is it just we are dealing with measures that are such crude measures, both of the characteristics and nature of the case and the information that the judges have presented to them is very crudely coded, very hard to include that, as well as our information about the judges themselves, as I said, is very crude. Would we make more progress and explain more of the variation with better measures of these extra legal factors if we had better measures? Or if we said we had better measures of the legal factors, both better measures of the facts, better measures of things like the standard of review, would that help us? My suspicion is we could, you know, we would do better along both dimensions. But in the end, I think what we'd be left with is a kind of mix, right? One sort of approach, one way to think about how to resolve this would be, and I don't think that people who work in this area typically do this, and so maybe this is an avenue for future research, is to increasingly they include measures of law, like the standard of review, or explicit measures of legally relevant facts as control variables, would be to compare how much of the variation in the outcome is explained by those features versus how much is explained by the extra legal factors of judicial preferences. And that might be a useful comparison. With regard to your first question about, you know, is it a few judges, is it particular cases, I think so. With regard to specific cases, I think Cass Sunstein's work is probably particularly useful here because he looked at a wide range of cases and a wide range of different subject areas of law. And across those wide range of subject areas, one still finds this influence of judicial ideology. It's not something that appears in certain areas versus another. But that, of course, is still problematic because that's still the whole set of decided cases on which opinions have been issued. Below that, there's a whole other set of disputes, both those that are litigated all the way and in circuits that do not allow or that permit decisions to be rendered without publication. There's some that have already been decided. But then there's others below that have been settled. And so would the judges' preferences correlate with outcomes in those cases as well, right? So that, I think, is something that is unknown and much more work is needed to be done. Now, with regard to whether or not there are specific judges, this is something that I think researchers in this area have kind of looked at in an informal way, in that I think if someone, you know, if we had someone here, or when I presented work like this, if you were to come up at the end and ask me, well, who in your data are really driving this result? Which judges? There may be some that I could actually pull out of the data and tell you. But the difficulty with these studies tends to be is that we don't have many repeat observations of the same judges. Instead, what we see are a slice of cases that are all about one area of law, and then a few repeat observations, you know, to get, say, four cases decided by one judge in your data set is a really large number. Now, when we're talking then about four decisions from that one judge, do we feel confident in saying that judge's patterns are clearly more ideological than some other judges? I don't think researchers are that confident in this area. Instead, I think what they are more confident of doing is saying, well, are there particular courts where the patterns of ideology seem more pronounced than others? And I think that the patterns there do confirm what are our suspicions about what are the most ideological courts or what are the most ideologically divided courts.
Tom, is there any evidence or any studies that look into a feedback mechanism? For example, as research is done at an accelerating rate about how judges behave, what are the influences on behavior, and to the extent that some of the behavior is not based on conscious decision making, but is sort of unconscious preferences. Do the judges actually maybe change their behavior in response to literature that suggests they're doing this? I mean, is there a way to test that? Is there any literature on that, that once it's called to the attention that ideology is playing a role, there's a counter force there? And feel free to deflect that to Judge Posner if you wish.
I don't know of any studies that have looked at that directly. I mean, it's a very interesting idea to think that by providing information to judges about their performance over a large host of cases and what patterns emerge from that is something that is a kind of criteria or evaluation that they should receive and what their response to that would be. I mean, I would be concerned that those, if we were to try to conduct this study in the real world, I think those judges who are kind of engaged with this sort of academic literature are in some ways atypical. And so it might be if we did detect responses from them, we'd worry that their responses would be atypical. But at the same time, I think there may be something to your suggestion because of what we, I think, know from some evidence in psychology about changes in behavior that can be induced just because someone knows they're being monitored, right? And so if we do, through statistical evidence, provide a different set of monitoring, does it change how a judge behaves? Now, it's odd to think that providing a judge with a kind of statistical spotlight would actually change their behavior in a way that actually the task of sitting down and writing an opinion wouldn't. Now, but of course, they participate in a lot of decisions in which they're not the primary author. So maybe there is a possibility for influencing behavior in that way.
Has there been any research into the behavior of other, like, maybe quasi-judicial actors, such as in agencies, administrative decisions, and sort of according to that, has there been any comparison into how those decision makers make decisions vis-a-vis how judges make them, because of their different employment situation, because of their different relationship with the people that they're adjudicating over? Has there been any sort of, I guess, comparison between those two?
Ooh, gosh, there are probably others in the room who know this better than I do. The question is whether or not there is a companion literature or literature to which the literature on judges can be compared about the decisions of agencies. And I think there is some literature on this. I mean, I can think of two strands, but they're very different, and I think they perceive themselves as answering different questions. One is there is a strand of literature on voting on the Federal Open Market Committee by the Federal Reserve and trying to predict what the members of that body will do in response to particular interest rates and so forth. And so part of this literature is just connected with, as you can imagine, in the financial industry, knowing what the Fed is going to do would be very important. And so in that sense, I think it's a literature that is focused just primarily on trying to predict behavior accurately. And I'm not quite sure if it has any normative content. The other literature is, I think there is some literature on boards like the FCC. I think there's some literature that tries to estimate from the FCC, you know, what are the true preferences of members of the board? Are their preferences stable over time? And tries to recover that information. Now, of course, agencies are engaged in a fundamentally different task. We think what they're doing is pure policymaking, right? And so when a member votes consistent with, you know, say the party of the president who appointed them, we're not surprised, and we don't think that's any cause for concern.
I wonder how well defined the distinction between an ideological and a legal decision is, given that a good ideology has a way of looking at the Constitution. Just as an example, looking back to Hamilton and Jefferson's disagreement about the constitutionality of the National Bank, each thought their view of the Constitution was the correct one. And you could also say, though, that they were very ideological. So I wonder, when you have a finding which crudely summarizes that when a judge feels they're being monitored by someone of a different party, they are very cautious. Another way to look at that might be not a reaction to monitoring, but the judges are following what they perceive to be some ideological consensus of the judicial system as a whole, as they fit into it. But it's not really that they want to be as ideological as they can get away with. It's rather that each ideological predilection has a different basic interpretation of the Constitution and the law. So that maybe looking at how a particular judge might advance what his or her ideology is, where that consists of trying to move the law in a certain direction, how fruitful that would be.
I think it's a very, when we start to push on these conceptions, right, it becomes very difficult to maintain the distinctions. One area of research, and a research area that I participated in, is to look at administrative agency decisions of judicial review of administrative agency decisions. And in this instance, courts are supposed to defer to the agency decision. And in that instance, we would think, well, if courts are going to defer, what the law is doing is it's telling the judges, well, don't allow your political preferences to be inserted or to influence you. Just so long as the agency's decision is reasonable and they follow good procedures, allow the agency decision to stand. But even in that area, I mean, a very strong finding, both in my work and in the work of others, has been that even in that domain, the political proxies for the judge still persist. And still have some explanatory power for the outcomes that the courts reach. And in that circumstance, well, there's a situation where we think politics and law, there's been some effort to separate, and yet we still see that there is an influence of what we think of as ideological or policy preference, apart from the command from the law to defer.
Yeah. A story, there may be competing stories, but a story that gets told about one method of regulating judges with lifetime tenure and that sort of thing is that there's this understanding on the part of the bench, especially the Supreme Court, that they can't vary too far from a common sense of what the American people or their political adversaries or even friends would see the law as. And one place where that story is sometimes told is, you know, through the whole evolution of the court and the New Deal legislation, those sorts of things. If we think of courts as somewhat sophisticated about sort of guarding their political capital, might a theory of judges as using political capital give us reason to think that these sorts of econometric analyses underestimate the effect that ideology has? Because if judges are using that capital, judiciously, then they will only spend it in areas where they are particularly interested in putting the thumb on the scale or particularly interested in moving something. So even if only 5% of cases are explained, it may be that that's vastly more than 5% of the influence and the movement in the judicial system that can be attributed to ideology. And is there any way to pick that up if that story has legs?
It's very interesting to think that the direction of bias in these cases is likely to be underestimated, right? That we think that the direction of bias is towards zero. The conventional view is not that The conventional thought on this is that because the cases that we see at the appellate level are atypical, we think that the bias that might arise would be, or any, I won't say bias, but the that the estimates would be overstated. That the cases that we see, because they are, because of the selection effect of the cases, we think they overstate the degree to which a judge's preference matters. Now, you're suggesting a different mechanism, and correct me if I'm mischaracterizing your characterization, but you're describing a more strategic characterization or a more strategic behavior by the judges with respect to how they are going to expend the capital or expend the resource they have with their colleagues. And so, of course, if they're exceedingly ideological, we think there might be some reaction from their colleagues, right? Now, that perhaps might explain or would be consistent with some of the panel effects that we find. And as I say, that this is a very active area of research, is to try to find out explanations for the panel effects and try to get purchase on what are the internal institutional dynamics among courts that either that would explain the panel effects. And I think that that's something that will be a very fruitful avenue that will help give us an understanding of whether or not the sort of the estimates that we have of judicial behavior are overestimates or underestimates because of the reaction of the judges. But it will leave kind of unanswered the issue of what are the impacts of the direction of bias on the selection from the arising from the selection of cases. Yeah.
Question. I think it's interesting the way that a lot of this literature tends to focus on civil appeals, because then you sort of have this assumption that, you know, the parties can strategically sort of, there will be a 50% likelihood that either party will win, at least theoretically. But it seems to me there are a large number of cases when that's not true, and you mentioned the finding about district court opinions and the correlation with appellate courts and the extent to which that shapes. And my question is, it seems to me that effect would hold true with regard to litigants. And I'm thinking, for example, of a prosecutor who, you know, a federal prosecutor who sits in the Fifth Circuit versus the Ninth Circuit may make sentencing decisions very differently, or, you know, may cast a case very differently because he knows that down the road, the way the sentencing might play out, for example, would be different. Or is there any look at the way that, you know, it seems to me that litigants would respond just as likely to those same factors as district courts would. And it seems to me that criminal cases in particular, because of the way they work, they're most likely to show these sort of litigant effects.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is what you're suggesting is a very interesting possibility, which is to say that the litigants on the ground understand the biases of the judges or the attitudes of the judges, and that what they do then is respond to that. And thus, that what we have is, rather than thinking about what is going on kind of at the top of the litigation pyramid, but to think about actors at an earlier stage looking ahead to that and then changing their behavior accordingly. I mean, I think that's a very important question, one that points us in a, it turns around the sort of the set of inquiries that law and economists have been undertaking here, because I think that the emphasis in law and economists has been to sort of look at the set of cases that are decided and take them all as kind of given. Right? Assume that they are all alike, or assume that through the process of the random assignment of cases to judges, both at the district court stage and then again the random assignment of appeals to appellate panels, washes out any of those differences on average. Now, the particular dynamic that you've suggested is one that would be a systematic difference across circuits. Right? So in response to Professor Milani's question, I said, that, well, there has been some inquiry into whether or not the supposed ideological effects are bigger in some circuits than another, right? And I attributed that, as I think the literature has attributed that, to differences in whether or not certain districts are more ideologically, or certain circuits are more ideologically polarized than others. And you're suggesting a different explanation, which is an explanation about there's something different about the nature of litigation that occurs within those circuits in response to what they perceive going on at the appellate stage. And that, I think, is an avenue that simply hasn't been explored. And so it's a very good suggestion.
Got time for one more.
For one more.
I know that part of the beauty of economic models is that it will simplify something difficult, but sometimes things might be lost in simplicity. So the Republican-Democrat split that's used, I would think most judges would identify not entirely along those party lines. And even if they maybe needed to toe the party line in order to get that nomination, those lines have shifted and drifted over time. So what is lost from the model by that simplification, and, or how difficult would it be to build in that robustness?
So I think that this is the question of how to measure a judge's ideological preferences is a really difficult one, and one that the literature has struggled with. And so there have been attempts to try to come up with a richer set of measures other than just party of the appointing president. And those measures, typically what they've done is they've taken ideological scores that have been developed in the context of the study of Congress or the presidency, and then tried to apply those to the judges themselves, but through the mechanism of what was the president who appointed them and what was the Senate who confirmed them. But of course, those are really not terribly good, right, measures, because what they do is they provide one measure of judicial attitudes for everything that appears before the judge, right? So a judge's attitude on or perspective on Fourth Amendment cases might be very different from the judge's perspective on civil litigation, right? And so those measures are a real limitation and a real shortcoming. Now, I guess, why don't we have better measures? As I say, there's some effort to try to get better measures. I think part of the limitation that we've had is part of my response to Professor Milani, which is in most of these studies, there are not repeated measurements of the same judge. The approach that some researchers are now taking is to say, let's look at a domain in which we can see many, many decisions from a judge. For example, like in an area with immigration cases, where there are many cases that come through, and we have many observations of how a judge resolved those cases. Can we use that set, that large body of decisions, to infer something about the judge's preferences, rather than going in the other direction, which is, let's take what we think of as a fixed measure of a judge's preference and see how it correlates with how cases are decided. Now, that is itself, an important avenue of research, but it's one that's really fraught with this significant limitation that it requires this large number of observations. Now, perhaps we will eventually get to the point where the judiciary is more cooperative in providing information about individual cases such that large end statistical analysis can be conducted. In a way, all of these cases are publicly available, but they require getting into PACER, which is costly, and going in and spending a great deal of time coding them and classifying them. The judiciary doesn't provide a whole lot of information that's readily amenable to a statistical researcher. Instead, it's the researcher who's got to go and develop the data set themselves. And that's a significant obstacle, I think, to trying to get both more accurate measures of the characteristics of the cases, but also to try to get characteristics of, or infer characteristics of the judges themselves.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.